It's the season to shop new styles, electronics, and definitely a holiday trip. And what if each time you made a purchase, you got a little something back? With Rakuten, you can earn cash back on just about anything you buy from over 750 stores. So if you're looking to buy a new phone, clothes, skincare, or a getaway, well, you can get cash back. So treat yourself, family, and friends, and book that holiday trip now. Start getting cash back today by joining Rakuten. It's free and easy to use, and you get cash back deposited into your PayPal account or sent to you as a check. It's the smartest way to shop, plain simple. Start your shopping at Rakuten.ca and get the Rakuten app. That's Rakuten.ca.
The views expressed in the following program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of Saga 960 AM or its management.
Welcome to nFocus with Annie J. Koshy, your window into stories that shape our world. I'm Annie, and today we have an inspiring guest who's tackling one of the planet's most pressing issues with creativity and innovation. Ashay Bhave is the founder of Thaely, and Thaely, for those of you who don't understand, is actually a plastic bag in Marathi. He joins us from India, and I'm very, very happy to be able to have him on board to share his remarkable journey. Welcome to the show, Ashay.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Well, I'm going to explore some of the pivotal moments and inspirations that really led Ashay on his remarkable journey of sustainability and entrepreneurship, uncovering really the driving forces behind his commitment to making a positive impact on the environment. Every year, around 100 billion plastic bags are used globally, consuming an estimated 12 million barrels of oil and causing the death of hundreds of thousands of marine animals. This is an environmental crisis, and it's something that really motivated Ashay. But before we dive into the story of Thaely, let's find out a little bit more about how a young mind was shaped into being sensitive about the impact as a humankind and the environmental legacy that both he and we all should be leaving. Now, it's a concept that adult minds around the world continue to grapple with. Ashay, millions of metric tons of plastic are produced worldwide every year. When did you first find yourself realizing that waste and plastic waste in particular was a big problem that needed tackling?
So I always sort of noticed the issue of plastic waste because my mom started one of the first waste management plants, that were sort of localized to a housing complex. So it's sort of like, it's zero waste, you just recycle everything in your complex. And then that same model was sort of used for a lot of other complexes in Bombay and around. There was this huge issue of plastic bags. They turn up in a lot of the waste and there wasn't any real way to recycle them. Plastic bottles have been recycled for, quite some time now, decades. But there wasn't really anybody recycling plastic bags that's when I first noticed it. And then also around the same time, that's when I was in Dubai. So I was staying in Dubai for a while and I'd heard about the ban on single-use plastic bags in India.
Right.
And then I ended up visiting India, during my summer vacations. And then I noticed that the ban's not being enforced at all.
Right. Being like, there was a time period where I was in India and it was something that our students did as part of their IB curriculum to in community service was to go and clean the plastics that was washed up on the sides of the rivers there, and they would have an environmental sort of cleanup day. But that's not enough, you know. In fact, pieces of plastic, ocean plastic waste, have come together really to create this vortex of plastic waste that's the size of France in the Pacific Ocean, that's between California and Hawaii, for example. And that is absolutely disgusting, you know. Now, I want to talk about some of the materials that have actually been used. You know, you've taken this plastic and you've repurposed it, this discarded plastic, and this concept of Thaely was born. We're going to dive really into the actual fabric that's created, etc. But very briefly, how do you create Thaely texts?
So Thaely Tex is a leather replacement that's made entirely out of waste plastic bags without the use of any chemicals. We make it in Delhi. So basically, first step is we work with a waste management plant that's based in Delhi and Gurgaon, basically the Delhi NCR region. And the first step is actually collecting the plastic bags, because, you know, unlike plastic bottles, you can't just go find, you know, you can't go to like a scrap yard and ask for like a bale of, you know, plastic bags, unlike right. plastic bottles. So that's the first step. So we work with this waste management plant. They collect it for us. They segregate it according to, you know, color. They sanitize them and then they send it to us. After that, they are all shredded, and we basically make these pellets out of them, and then it's sort of melted down and, you know, created into these pellets, and then that these pellets are then extruded into rolls of fabric. And all of this process is something that I've invented, and you know, the machinery is all custom built, and it's also something that we're patenting right now. The name's already like trademarked and all of that.
Now, it's quite interesting to hear this process, and it's not just sustainable, it's also innovative. And we're going to be diving into the impact that this has on sustainability, the environmental impact. We're going to be diving into it, because it's not just about the running shoes. Thaely actually is also about the packaging that's used. The shoe boxes are eco-friendly. They're made with recycled paper that's dyed with waste coffee grounds. The actual shoe boxes are have seeds for basil that's embedded in it, so that every aspect of this company is ensuring that nothing goes to waste and that nothing is left to just sit and rot to no use, that things are going to be coming out from this. We are in conversation with Ashay Bhave here on Saga 960. And if you're just tuning in, you can catch our show every Saturday at 4 p.m. on News Talk Saga 960 AM. Be sure to follow Saga 960 AM on Instagram and on Facebook. And you can also connect with me on Instagram under the handle Annie J. Koshy, or follow GTA South Asian Media Network for more updates. Stay tuned for part two of In Focus with me as I explore Thaely's mission and the challenges of entrepreneurship in the sustainability sector. I'll be back right after this message.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy. We're back with Ashay Bhave, the visionary entrepreneur behind Thaely. Ashay, in our previous segment, you described your journey from the initial Thaely Tex fabric prototype. I want to talk about you having won a Shark Tank type competition. Can you tell us more about that pivotal moment and the early days of Thaely?
So yeah, initially it was just a design project. It was one of many design projects that I was working on. I'd finished design school in New York, and then I was back in Dubai. That's where my parents were. I was doing a business degree, and then the plan was to do like a like a management design course, something like that. And then I didn't have a lot of work experience, so the way to fix that is that you sort of have a great portfolio.
Yes, and do as much volunteer work and do everything, right? And learn everything.
Yeah. So, this was one of the projects that I was working on. And basically the goal was to find a way to recycle these plastic bags. First step was just, making the fabric. So, I did a lot of research. I was sort of just experimenting at home. It took a lot of trial and error. Honestly, it wasn't like, it wasn't like a sort of eureka moment. It just took months of trial and error, and I had this rough fabric ready, and then I was visiting India again, and then I gave the fabric to like a local sort of cobbler, and he made a shoe using the fabric. It was sort of also to sort of, it was a proof of concept, and to also prove that you can make a shoe out of this fabric with just existing, production techniques.
Right. Now, during the competition, you had the privilege of meeting Matteo Bofa. What was that like? He was one of the judges on Shark Tank.
So I was pretty well prepared. I had the prototype. I had a very good business plan. And, regardless of whether I was going to win the competition or not, I sort of knew already that I had something pretty special with this business. And, I'd already like registered the domain name, and I was already figuring things out. And, this was like a Shark Tank pitch event that my college organizes. So it's not like, you really get investment or any of that. The only thing you really win is they give you a year or 2 years of office space.
Right.
In the university's incubation area, which is quite nice, but it's like one cubicle,
trying to create brilliance in that one cubicle. Now, you won the competition, and that must have been very incredibly validating. How did Matteo's involvement really shape the future of Thaely?
So right there at the competition, he said, I want to actually invest. So just, meet me tomorrow, and, we'll draw out a gentleman's agreement, and, we'll start working on stuff. Let's make a more refined prototype. So yeah, it was, everything was very quick. Right after the competition, I think we had a prototype ready in 2 months, and then we I'd raised about $60,000 then, and then we wanted to raise another $100,000.
Is this dollars or in rupees that you're talking about?
No, dollars.
Okay.
US dollars.
Okay. Yeah. Interesting.
And we sort of wanted to raise a lot more money, $100,000, because it's making shoes is not as easy as just like printing t-shirts. There's a lot more involved, especially, we were doing something that's not been done before. There was a whole supply chain that needed to be designed. It's a whole new product. Everything's, sort of custom made. Nothing's just
right. And I think you had a process of where you needed to go through and refine the fabric that you were developing using these plastics. And also, Like you were mentioning, it was a continual sort of learning cycle for you. How long did the final sort of production-ready sneaker take?
I mean, when I got the investment, that was right at the start of 2020. So we had, you know, like a huge delay because of COVID. You know, it was
exactly.
almost a year and a half. So if it wasn't for COVID, I would say we would have a finished prototype probably in half a year.
Right.
But then just, you know, it took like a year and a half and a few more months. And
yeah.
Ultimately we launched in July of 2021. So
now the journey from prototype to a production ready product is incredibly challenging as well as rewarding. Were there any significant lessons or experiences that stand out in that phase for you?
I mean, honestly, the biggest hurdle was probably finding the actual plastic bags.
Okay.
There was no supply chain for it. So, you know, I had to go convince waste management plants and scrap yards to work with me, and that was pretty difficult because, like, you know, initially you don't have very large quantities.
It's the season to shop new styles, electronics, and definitely a holiday trip. And what if each time you made a purchase, you got a little something back? With Rakuten, you can earn cash back on just about anything you buy from over 750 stores. So if you're looking to buy a new phone, clothes, skincare, or a getaway, well, you can get cash back. So treat yourself, family, and friends, and book that holiday trip now. Start getting cash back today by joining Rakuten. It's free and easy to use, and you get cash back deposited into your PayPal account or sent to you as a check. It's the smartest way to shop, plain simple. Start your shopping at Rakuten.ca and get the Rakuten app. That's Rakuten.ca.
You know, they deal in tons and, you know, hundreds of tons. So, you know, convincing somebody to give you a few hundred kilos is quite a challenge. And, you know, you sort of have to sell them the vision. And then finally some, you know, like a scrap company sort of approached me themselves. Like, you know, they'd seen like an article or something about us. And they said, we're interested, you know, we're also trying to bring about a change. And, you know, I was grateful enough to find the right partner because, you know, apart from, you know, finding the plastic bags and all of that, it was also very important for us that the people who actually work at the waste management plant, you know, they've got good working conditions, they've got, you know, fair pay, you know, everything is in order, everything, all the certifications are there.
Mm-hmm.
That was a challenge also.
Now, Thaely has expanded its presence globally. Could you tell us a little bit more about the reach of Thaely, the markets, and where Thaely is currently available?
So to start with, you know, we're available globally through our website. You know, we're doing free shipping right now, but generally it's between $10 to $20 all across the world. We are also in a bunch of stores. We're in a few stores in India. We're in a few stores in UAE. We're in a few stores in Switzerland. Also in Australia and New Zealand. And then at the end of this year, we're launching physically in parts of Europe. So we're launching in France, Germany, UK.
When are you getting to Toronto? Toronto's got a big market. We're all about the environment here in Canada. So be sure to have a Canadian branch of Thaely. And if you're ever in the Toronto region, I definitely want to see you and your team come in and have access to, you know, the people here who are all about, you know, sustainable living and ensuring that we are producing eco-friendly products. Now, as I jump into that question there, the sustainability market has been rapidly growing. How do you perceive competition, and really why should consumers choose sustainable products?
So like you said, it's growing. You know, there it's not fully matured yet. So it's not like there's one clear sort of industry leader. I mean, there's, you know, there's Veja that's been around for like 10, 15 years, which is why they're probably doing the best. But, you know, it's, there's enough space, you know, ultimately the goal is to have as many sustainable sneaker brands as possible. You know, we're just doing our part. We're, you know, we're making innovations where people haven't yet. You know, we're also working with a bunch of new materials that, you know, nobody else in the industry has worked with so far. Sorry, what was the second part of the question?
Yeah, so one thing is it's about that, but then a lot of customers, consumers choose mainstream products as versus a sustainable product. Why should consumers choose, and how can you make sustainable products viable or enticing? You know, there is this technique a lot of companies, and I heard this for the first time as I was preparing for this, and it's called greenwashing.
Right.
Let's talk about some of these. These are some of the issues that are holding back true sustainable, you know, development.
You know, so at least, you know, our way to sort of combat this is that we're very, you know, transparent about our practices. All of our products, and packaging, it's got like a QR code on it. You can scan it and it basically tells you everything that you need to know about the product, you know, exactly how much recycled content is in the product, where it's sourced from, all our certifications. You know, we're also one of the only companies and probably the only sneaker brand that uses 100% recycled fabrics. That's quite rare. And also, you know, with Thaely, you know, there's sort of a clear story. Like, you know, India has a problem of plastic waste. We're recycling everything in India. You know, we're making the shoe in India. You know, we're providing employment. So, you know, there's a very clear story. It's not like, you know, we're making the shoes in India, but we're importing this from China. You know, everything is centralized in one location. Our goal is to sort of have as low carbon emissions as possible. And, you know, I think it's just about being as honest as possible.
You know, as a young person who started out on an entrepreneurial journey, there are lots of challenges that I'm sure that you sustained along the way. I'm going to ask you a few of these, and very briefly, just tell us, so our listeners understand, what was it like having limited experience? Was that ever a challenge for you?
It was definitely a challenge for me, but like even though I did do BBA entrepreneurship,
right,
there's no sort of, you know, I don't think there's, you can have enough experience to become an entrepreneur. You know, there's no
You're
way
right. to, from finances to the marketing to operations to figuring it out. Yeah.
Exactly. There's no job or, you know, sort of, you know, whatever educational qualification that can prepare you to be an entrepreneur. So, you know, it's just things that you have to learn on the way. You know, you just have to make sure that you have enough of a bandwidth to make mistakes. Yeah.
Absolutely. And you know what? This is what I really liked about this brand, which came across my feed completely by chance. And I took this chance, and I had been in communication with some of Ashay's team in order to put this together. Despite all of these challenges, young entrepreneurs like Ashay often bring fresh perspectives, innovation, and a strong commitment to making positive impact, which can really drive their success in the long run. Stay tuned for part 3, where I'm going to delve into Thaely's impact on plastic waste reduction and the future of sustainable fashion.
No radio,
No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, and we're here with Ashay Bhave, the visionary founder of Thaely. Ashay, in this segment, let's talk about Thaely's vision and your advice for fellow young entrepreneurs. You mentioned that you want to really make Thaely like a household name. You're now approaching several international markets. And, you know, in some interviews, you've said you want Thaely to be like a Xerox machine, you know, in the Xerox in the photocopy industry where everyone recognizes it. Or you can talk about any other major brand where everyone just sees the symbol and understands right away it's that brand. Can you elaborate some of your vision for your brand?
I mean, the goal would be to, you know, to just sort of go out and see people wear our shoes, you know, not at an event or any of that, you know, just on the road in the wild. And like, you know, you shouldn't have to say that, oh, I'm wearing Thaely's. I think, you know, the goal is that people know it already and, you know, they know what it is, what the brand is, all of that.
So for all of you, all of my listeners who are chiming in right now and listening in, I actually went and stalked their website and I've already set my eyes on a couple of things. I was having a hard time. There were three there. I'm sure if you know me very well, you'll know which ones I'm gravitating to. But if you don't, you'll have to see them on my feet. And I'm going to have a heart-to-heart conversation with this young man when we get off of this show. But if you haven't checked them out, you need to go onto their website and check out which one you want to wear. Ashay, I wanted to ask you a question. I would think of something like plastic not being as durable as a product like leather. Let's talk about the durability of the shoes that you're making and whether I would experience that it's going to peel after a while or something.
Okay. The people that produce our shoes, it's a company called Bata.
We know Bata. We call it Bata here.
it's a 100 or more year old company. I think it's 120 yes. years. They've, you know, all the testing sort of certifications that you can go get, a lot of them were sort of specified by Bata.
You know, to speak on Bata, we actually have a Bata museum here in Toronto, which I think it's a museum on shoes. So it would be great when you make your Toronto visit. See, I'm putting it out there in the universe that you're going to come with a series of Thaely shoes and we're going to do Thaely at Bata Museum, right? Which would be an awesome moment. But yes, Bata is known for their, well, we know them as chappals or flip-flops, but the rubber chappals is a sustainable product that Bata has been doing for decades, I would say.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, we've got a really good manufacturer who does, who helps with sourcing and development. You know, all our products are sort of tested in-house. You know, we get a proper test report. We know exactly how long things are going to last. And, you know, we had to sort of pass the Bata testing factors, which are, you know, they're quite sort of stringent about things. We wouldn't even have gone into production if our shoe wasn't durable, you know, they just wouldn't have touched it. So they last as long as pretty much any sneakers, you know, even when you wear them or when you see them in real life, I don't think most people would be able to tell that they're made from recycled plastic. We've got some new products coming out that actually have like leather grain texture on it.
Oh, that's so super cool.
Yeah, that's going to make it even more difficult for people to tell if it's recycled plastic or not. I mean, you know, it's just, you know, right now, yeah, you might you know, if you know about the brand and stuff, then you might be able to tell, you know, that it's made from, you know, the plastic bags or plastic bottles or whatever. But yeah, when you actually wear it, I or like see them, I don't think
you would have that. Now, there is another brand that's out in the market, and this brand is one where you can wear it in water, you can wear it in, you know, through mud, nothing sticks to it. And that's something that I think would add another layer, perhaps, and go into a direction where not only is it sustainable, but it's also something that you can wear in a variety of weather, especially in the spring and fall here in Toronto. I would say that things can get mucky. And so to be able to wear white running shoes and be able to come home and wash that muck off and it still be white is something that's really interesting. Now, personal branding plays a significant role in founder-led startups. Can you share your thoughts on the importance of personal PR for entrepreneurs, especially in the early stages of a startup?
Yeah, I mean, you know, in the early stage, you don't, you know, you're sort of selling yourself. You're not, you know, there isn't any brand or business to speak of, really. So it's just, you know, you have to sell yourself. You know, you need to come across as somebody that investors or, you know, customers would sort of trust and would want to invest in, you know. Yeah, so I mean, I don't know, it's not like I, you know, went ahead and made a personal brand or any of that. You know, I've just always been myself. I've not tried to come across as somebody who I'm not. You know, I don't really believe too much in sort of self-promotion on Instagram and things like that. It's just, you know, I'd rather have people sort of, I don't know, talk about me or write about me.
Right. That's true. There's always a value when someone else speaks, but being a personal brander myself and someone who advocates about personal branding, understanding the story behind your brand is what personal branding is about. And what you've shared today is what the personal brand is. There is a vision, there's a story. And when you're relating to consumers, they want to be able to relate to a story that they can see themselves in, that if they were to take the protagonist, the antagonist, they can see all of those characters because it's part of their everyday. When you start connecting to people on that personal brand story level, you're able to really speak to their heart. And when you have people tying into the emotive side of your brand, then you have them believing in your brand, not just for that one single product, but in the purpose and the mission behind your brand. So I think that gone are the days where you could separate your personal from your professional, and you can start a business and no one needs to know what your personal is about. Now, if your personal is not synonymous with what your brand's mission is in terms of your professional brand, then people are not going to believe in you and not see your credibility. And that, I think, is the essence of what personal branding in today's environment is. So it's not about doing the selfies on Instagram or on Facebook. It's not about self-promotion in a manner in which you're promoting something irrelevant. It's about self-promotion in alignment with the mission and vision of what your brand story is about, right through every single interaction. The minute you step out of your front door, you are your brand. So you eat, speak, sleep, think, breathe your brand. And that, I think, is why you have the credibility and you're able to push forward your brand's vision here.
Right.
So now your motto is don't just do it right. And this really reflects, Ashay, on your meticulous approach to business. Can you really explain the significance of this motto that you have and share any advice to young entrepreneurs that are tuning in right now?
You know, I think, you know, this motto also sort of is like a comeback at a lot of brands greenwashing, you know, there were a bunch of sort of very old sort of heritage brands, you know, trying to get into sustainability, and you know, it was sort of half-assed. You know, it was, you know, the sustainable fabrics that they used, they weren't really sustainable or as sustainable as they claimed they were. It was more like, you know, you just have to take their word for it that this is a,
right,
you know.
So you're talking about, is there enough accountability in the sector?
No, I mean, see, at this point, I don't think so. It's just, you know, all the certifications that a lot of these big brands are able to get, you know, they don't, you know, there isn't a lot of sort of background checks or, you know, any of that that's really done. There's one sort of auditor that comes once a year, and that's about it. You know, so yeah, I think you know, like we're recently trying to get our B Corp certification, and you know, it's pretty much impossible for any sort of big brand to get. But yeah, we're just about to apply, and I think we'll have it by the end of this year.
And if you can explain what that is, because I'm not familiar with that term. What is that?
Yeah, so B Corp is sort of a certificate that, you know, not only looks at your product, but it also looks at your entire business practice. It, you know, it looks at the people that you've employed, the vendors that you work with. You know, it's a more sort of holistic approach, and it's a lot more stringent. It's something that's constantly updated. So, you know, if there's a new requirement, you have to go comply to that. Yeah, so, you know, not a lot of companies have it. I think in India, there's 7 or 10 at the most that have it.
Right.
And, you know, even across the world, it's a very low number, especially in the fashion and specifically footwear industry. It's
right.
It's quite rare.
Now, I want to talk very briefly before we go into commercial break about the practical tips for plastic and waste reduction that everyday person can just take or consider in their life. Let's talk about reducing the single-use plastics, which we are all aware of. We have here in Toronto and in Canada, we have more stringent laws with the use of single-use plastics and also other products, not just the bags, but cutlery, straws, and I guess using more sustainable alternatives, recyclable alternatives like cloth bags, stainless steel utensils, or vegan versions of utensils that are there. How can people recycle effectively, Ashay?
I think, you know, the best thing that you could do is reusing, you know, one step before recycling. I would say start with the reusing. You know, a lot of people in India, and I'm sure, you know, the Indian diaspora in Canada and in North America also sort of follows the same practices that we do in India, where, you know, you just reuse containers and,
yeah,
you know, you repurpose them for other things. I think that's probably step one. You know, the things that you can't recycle very well, I would say, or like sort of reuse and repurpose at home. You know, at least in India, I don't know how it is in Canada, but like we don't have to separate your wet waste and your dry waste and all of that.
Yeah, we do that here. It's quite stringent. So they're quite strict about being able to sort out, you know, your garbage versus your green waste as versus your recyclable items, and then what can actually go into the different things. So whether it is that you are upcycling, repurposing, recycling it effectively, or choosing sustainable products that you and your family are deciding to invest in, reducing your food waste so that there are minimum amount of organic waste that's going into our fills, bring your own bottles. bottles, bring your own sort of containers. So if you're carrying lunch to work or kids are carrying it to school, to have it in containers that they can use again. And to repair rather than replace, you know, don't chuck it out when something can be fixed. Find someone who can actually do the fixing, and electronics, appliances that can be repaired will help also to extend the lifespan of those products. So those are a couple of very, very simple suggestions that are there that Ashay has also been sharing about. It main thing is to educate and engage. So educate yourself about some of those environmental impacts that you can make. But incorporating these practices into your daily life, you can really help make a significant step towards the reduction of plastics and the plastic waste. And this is all in alignment with what Thaely's vision is of a more sustainable future and a sustainably environmentally conscious world. Stay tuned for part four. We're going to dive into Thaely's remarkable journey, continue that journey, and, you know, look at how they continue to empower a community. This is In Focus with Annie J. Koshy here on Saga 960. I'm going to be back right after this message.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, and we're here with Ashay Bhave, the visionary founder of Thaely. Ashay, it's truly inspiring to hear about Thaely's commitment to sustainability and ethical practices. Can you tell us what's next for Thaely and what are some of your ongoing initiatives?
We're going to have two new colors and two models drop every month or up until Feb. So, you know, so that's a bunch of shoes.
Wow.
So this month onwards, we're going to have new releases every single month. That's pretty exciting. It's also, you know, a whole new shoe. So, you know, we're not doing small color variations. It's, you know, completely different new silhouettes every month.
Which is quite interesting because you have right now on your website a couple of versions where you have your completely white shoe, you have your white and black shoe, you have your black shoe, then you have your white shoe with the black trim, you have your white shoe with the red trim. You see, I've been on your website. I know your stuff, all right? Yes. And so now we're going to go into other color models, which is great. And I believe, how do you report your information against the United States nation's sustainable development goals? How do you compare them?
So we've got like an impact page on our website. Our website's www.thaely.com. So we've got an impact page. We've sort of listed out the SDG goals that, you know, we're trying to approach and we're trying to sort of solve and support through Thaely. We also report exactly the number of plastic bags and plastic bottles we recycle every month. It's updated every week. In the next sort of month or so, we're going to make this even more detailed. Even sort of more involved. Just to improve our transparency and all of that.
Now, carbon footprint reduction is also something that's crucial in today's day and age. How is Thaely addressing this issue and really minimizing carbon emissions during the production process?
For example, right now with our shipping, We're going to start offering green shipping services. So, you know, it's going to be slightly more expensive, but I'm sure there's customers who would rather pay a little extra for sustainable shipping. We're also working with companies in India that use electric vehicles for like last mile delivery.
Right.
Apart from that, the water that we use for
I was going to get to that. Yes.
Sanitizing plastic bags, it's recycled.
Right.
You know, it's gray water.
Yeah, because water conservation is another really vital aspect of sustainability. And the very fact that Thaely is implementing water-saving techniques speaks to the very fact of your attitude towards water management. You also invest in certain technologies that recycle and treat water. What type of dyes do you use or detergents do you use? Are these things that are sustainable and environmentally friendly?
Yeah, we sort of use, you know, like bio sort of dyes, like, you know, they're and sort of bio detergents. So it's not, they're not, you know, they're not as toxic as, you know, like regular detergent when you release it, you know, it's sort of easy to recycle, basically, the water. Also, the glue that we use is vegan, and it's, you know, it's like a water-based glue. So it's overall better for the environment.
Right.
The ink that we're using for the box is also sustainable ink.
Yeah, I actually want to talk about the packaging because, well, first off, you've got reduced packaging waste, and that's a really commendable initiative. Can you tell us a little bit more about how Thaely is minimizing packaging waste and promoting eco-friendly packaging?
Yeah, so the box that the shoes are shipped in, they are made from recycled paper. They're dyed with waste coffee grounds. And they've got basil seeds embedded in the box. So you can actually plant the box itself. Apart from that, you know, there's a lot of brands that offer dust bags. You know, sort of the higher end brands, they offer dust bags with their shoes. But, you know, there's not much you can do with a dust bag after you buy the shoe. You know, very rarely does somebody put the shoes back in the dust bag and then back in the closet.
I do. All my shoes are in my dust bags. That was the best part of buying shoes in India because they don't do that here. It was were these dust bags, and every single shoe goes with a dust bag whenever, especially when I'm on set. So I loved those dust bags, and I am a creature of habit, and all of my shoes are in them. So I hope Thaely decides to continue with reusable dust bags. I think that it's a great idea.
But we've got something better that I would say is more functional. We offer these tote bags that the shoe is wrapped in. And they're also made from 4 plastic bottles. And you can just use it as a shopping tote itself. And apart from that, when we ship our shoes, you know, we don't use any additional sort of plastic, you know,
right.
Because a lot of times brands sort of, you know, apart from the shoe box, there's an outer carton.
Right.
There's an out sleeve, so you know there's a bunch more packaging, and you know most of our customers they don't really care about the box being in pristine condition, or you know it's they're okay with it. You know, anyways, they're going to cut it up and plant it. So.
Right. Well, you know, this show could go on and on. There's so much information. This young person is a wealth of knowledge about sustainable living, sustainable production of products. Ashay, what's a good location that people can find out more? Can you spell out for my listeners where they can find out more about Thaely?
So we ship globally through our website. It's www.thaely.com.
How do you spell Thaely? Because not everyone's.
Yeah, sorry. It's thaely.com.
And there you have it. So as we wrap up another insightful episode of In Focus with NEJ Koshy, I'm really truly inspired by the incredible individuals and stories that I've had the privilege to explore, especially today, from visionary entrepreneurs like Ashay Bhave, who are leading the charge in sustainable fashion, to artists, activists, and change makers from diverse backgrounds. Each of them is a beacon of hope and inspiration. It's a reminder that in our ever-changing world, there are individuals and organizations committed to making a positive impact on our planet, as well as society. So whether it's through sustainable practices, ethical initiatives, or creative endeavors, they're showing us that a better, more conscious world is not just a dream, but an achievable reality. I want to extend my gratitude to all my guests for sharing their journeys, their insights, and their passions with me and my listeners. And to all of you, my wonderful listeners, thank you for joining me on this journey. Now, remember, if you have a story to share, whether you're an entrepreneur, an artist, or someone with a unique perspective, reach out to me at info@saga960am.ca. Attention Annie or the Ninja. Let's continue to spotlight the incredible individuals and ideas that make our world a better place. If you missed out on any part of today's show or want to catch up on previous episodes, visit the website at www.sauga960am.ca, where you'll find a podcast of this and other great shows. Stay curious, stay compassionate, and stay tuned for more engaging conversations on In Focus with Annie J. Koshy. Until next time, have a fantastic day and continue to be your beautiful self.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.